This week on Top Billing, get ready to have your hearts melt with the story of Osita, the little warrior rhino. Freediving champion Hanli Prinsloo is saving our oceans one giant breath at a time. Cutting-edge stylists pair high street collections to put SA fashion on the world stage. Mexican meets South African in a carnival of flavour from two award-winning chefs. The world's first luxury compact convertible SUV goes head-to-head with the raw power of nature. After 26 years of wedded bliss, Letty and Boy Ngobeni are so in love, they get married again. And your presenter tonight, Queen Bee, brings you our lineup from the home of reconstructive surgeon Dr Ridwan Mia.
Good evening, and I think we can say it's the cutest ever. Welcome to Top Billing for tonight as we celebrate International Rhino Day. If we didn't already have a soft spot for these wonderful creatures and our need to protect them, this little guy turned us into marshmallow.
To mark the sixth year of World Rhino Day, we'd come to a private game reserve in the Karoo. The day now encompasses all five species of African and Asian rhino, and head ranger Timothy van der Westhuizen oversees a healthy herd right here.
Working with wild animals must come with a lot of challenges.
Oh, definitely, especially to protect our rhinos. We actually had an incident in the past where two of our male rhinos actually got killed by poachers. Which is basically the saddest part of it all. The one male was the firstborn white rhino in the Western Cape area for over 250 years. And because of our poaching that actually went along, or actually happened, we had started this organization, Saving Private Rhino. It's all the proceeds, people when they buy t-shirts and wristbands, all the proceeds actually goes to that organization and goes to other game reserves, and they're given the anti-poaching training, actually helping to protect their rhinos, night visions and stuff like that, all the basically the stuff they need.
Are they under constant observation?
We have to now, because these animals, these two to three rhinos being killed every single day. We need to protect our rhinos now. There is some of our guys actually out in the fields, but they are there protecting our rhinos now.
You've been here for 11 years. What's it like seeing these rhino grow up?
Oh, it's just a complete privilege to actually see these animals basically grow. Especially these babies that's actually been born here, which is indicating to us that we are actually doing something right. So they actually naturally occur in this area, and they actually can easily adapt to the natural habitat.
It was on New Year's Eve, almost 10 months ago, that this white rhino calf was found alone on the reserve. Confusing another calf for her own, the mother had abandoned her baby. Conservation manager Dirvan Hrobla and his team tried reintroducing the calf to his mother, but she rejected him again. It became clear he'd have to be hand-reared, and he needed companions.
Dirvan, one man, one rhino, and a goat. Walking through the bush, you do not see that every day.
Yeah, we're very blessed and fortunate, and it's the best job in the world.
These two look like they are joined at the hip.
Yeah, we needed to make a plan, and rhinos are not, they don't do well in solitary areas, so we needed to make a companion, and that's where Bocky came along. And the initial plan was for her to teach him how to graze, because I can't go on my knees and hands and teach him how to eat grass, and that's a plan, and she did it very successful, and also they've become like jam and butter together. They're best friends and companions, and that's also very important for us to stage development and also where we're going to wean off the human contact more, and then their companionship can go further for the introduction into back into the wild.
This daily run gets him strong for the vast distances rhinos walk looking for food. Dirvan initially thought stress might get the better of his young charge, but he's proved a strong survivor.
So the mud bars are very vital for them. It protects them from parasites. It's a sunscreen. It's also a moisturizer for their skin. Mm-hmm. And when he was a baby, we used to put sunscreen on him, because in the wild, his mom's shadow would guard him from the sun protection. And the sunblock helped it, because my shadow wasn't as big as his mom would be as a rhino in the wild. And this is the part where you just get muddy and dirty. Just be a rhino with him. And the thing is, about his skin, you think it's so thick and strong, but he can feel a fly sit on his skin and he gets irritated just by a fly sitting on his skin. That's how sensitive their skin is. So Jade, how does it feel to get all muddy with a rhino?
I'm actually really, really enjoying this. You're giving me a mud mask. I can't believe you. How strong are rhinos?
So for a baby that's 10 months old,
yeah,
he lifts this whole tire up with his neck.
Just his neck?
Just with his neck.
Each day, he drinks up to a fifth of his own body weight in a formula similar to his mother's own milk.
Devon, what's the temperature of this milk?
So the temperature of the milk is a body temperature that we need to give it to him. That will come out of his mom. So it's normally 37 degrees.
Okay.
And he drinks now, he drinks 5 feeds every 4 hours a day, and it's 6 liters of feed that we give him. So approximately about 30 liters a day he drinks now. And he consumes, and he started eating solids also.
All right. Well, it looks like he's come to the end of
this feed. So he can just pull it out, and then he's done.
Woo.
There you go, good boy, good boy.
He's got such a lovely nature.
Yeah, it's very gentle. You've been thinking, he's so big and strong, he can just turn around and knock you off your feet. But he's so soft and gentle.
While he gathered his strength, an SMS competition saw him named Osita, an Igbo word, meaning from today onwards, it will be better.
I have to tell you how grateful I am for this experience. It was such a privilege to be able to stroke a rhino calf to sleep.
Jade, you are so privileged because we don't allow people actually to come into the bowman. We only got 4 carers that stay with him through this period to release. And we just wanted to create that awareness for rhino rehabilitation.
Speaking of which, what is the next step to release him back into the wild?
So the next step is he's got another year to be weaned off milk. And slowly we're going to reduce to human contact. And the reason why we do the walks every day also is to get him used to the area where he's going to be pre-released into the area for a few years before we're going to relocate him to another reserve.
Why do you have to relocate him?
His genetics is the same, similar here, and also there's already an alpha male in the vicinity here. But also when we're going to release him, he's going to still be accepted into the crush of rhinos as a juvenile, and the alpha male won't see him as a threat yet.
Osita is vital in the conservation effort, as he can supply a strong bloodline and genetics to contribute to the future of the white rhino.
Nothing beats seeing wildlife in person. And thanks to people like Timothy and Devon, hopefully we'll be able to see our rhino population continue to grow for generations to come.
If you'd like to assist this little fighter as he builds up his strength, log on to topbilling.com for details.
Moisturizing mud baths, sunscreen, plus 42 pints of milk a day, and they call us girls divas. But what price can you put on conserving our heritage, especially when he's as gorgeous as that?
Coming up, is it a fish or is it a dolphin? No, it's a mermaid from Pretoria. And new generation SA Design gets a big break.
It's easy to pitch conservation with an adorable baby rhino, but the campaign to sustain our fish populations has been in need of a similar poster child. What it got in free diver Hanli Prinsloo is a superhero, a mermaid making much needed waves on a subject we cannot ignore.
Hanli is devoted to giving others an ocean experience that transforms their appreciation of our blue planet. She's an 11-time South African freediving record holder, actress, documentary filmmaker, and an activist for sustainable management of our marine life. Her journey began in a landlocked part of the country.
So how did a little girl from a farm outside of Pretoria get into freediving? I've always been fascinated by how quiet it gets underwater and what a special world it is down there. And so I actually started freediving in Sweden. I met a freediver on a job there and he started coaching me. So even though a lot of people complain about cold Cape Town water, I'm like, have you dived in fjords? This is balmy compared to that. Personally, I find diving in general one of the most intimidating sports. What are some of the risks that come with it? A lot of people think freediving is really dangerous because you're diving on one breath and you don't have the assistance of scuba tanks and stuff. But that in fact is not true. Because you're using your own breath, it's such a mental practice of how deep am I going, how long am I down there for, that it's all very much this within your own ability approach as opposed to trusting the equipment. And then the other perceived risk is, of course, the ocean is full of things that want to eat you, and that's not true at all, thank goodness. I mean, you know, we have so many sharks here and that's not a problem, it's a healthy ecosystem. One doesn't break 11 South African free diving records without intense training. So what goes into it? Free diving training is a mixture of aerobic and anaerobic training. So swimming is really good because already in the swimming training, you're limiting your breathing. The aerobic training like running and cycling is good because you do get fit, but it also makes your muscles very oxygen hungry, which isn't good for free diving. So the best can actually be done on a yoga mat, and it's different kinds of yoga stretching. More than anything, stretching the muscles over the chest, between the ribs and over the back, to open up the thoracic cavity so you get a bigger breath. Well, I know I'm going to be getting in the water, so shall we get stretching? Yep, let's stretch your lungs.
Yoga is helpful for those pushing beyond the depth of 30 meters. Since the father of modern freediving, Jacques Mayol, introduced it in the 60s, it's become central to freedive training.
Now that we've prepared our lungs and our body for freediving, we can get into our wetsuits, and I've brought my monofin for you to try out and be a real freediver underwater.
Part of the yoga technique that allows Hanli to dive to 40 meters or below is the relaxation of the mind through controlled breathing. Using this training, she can slow her metabolism and control her heart rate. The idea of a human being so at one with the ocean has become part of her inspirational speaking. But her message of ocean conservation is always best communicated in the water.
That felt so natural. What a lot of fun. I'd love to show you the rest of Cork Bay, but one more dive. Okay, you want more. Thank you.
Getting youngsters' feet wet in the sea off Cork Bay is central to her awareness campaign of saving our seas. A salty kid is a happy kid, says Hanli.
From one ocean lover to another, I think it's extremely admirable that you started the I Am Water Foundation, and I believe you run it from here.
The projects of I Am Water focus on introducing people to the ocean. So here in South Africa and other countries around the world, we work with underprivileged coastal communities, and we teach them snorkeling, we teach them ocean awareness, and we show them how their choices and their lifestyle impact on the ocean. And even the shop is more than just a shop. We have products that you can take home and remember the ocean, and also things that are organic and a different way of living, but also all the proceeds go to the projects of the foundation.
Working a lot with children from the nearby fishing communities, it helps to live where she works.
So, welcome.
Thank you. This home is so you.
I know, I love this house. From the very first time I walked in here, I had this feeling that this is my sanctuary, this is where I want to live. And I keep collecting things from all over the world that reminds me of the ocean to really, yeah, I guess, bring the sea into my home. And it's one of the oldest houses in Cork Bay, actually. So the house has its own story, and everything in the house has a story. And you'll see everywhere there's these sculptures scattered around, and that's all my sister's work. And we grew up on a horse farm outside Pretoria and dreamt of being mermaids. And of course, you know, as we realized that mermaids aren't real, I decided I'd be a freediver. But my sister's still inspired by the ocean.
Hanli is a vegetarian, so we were keen to find out how that squares with the demands of her sport.
What is your daily diet being a freediver?
I usually start my morning with either a smoothie or like a chia pot with yogurt and some fruits and nuts. For lunch, something kind of light and green, some kind of salad. And then in the evening, maybe this kind of salad plus grains or something with tempeh or tofu or something. I'm really specific about making sure I get enough protein, which a lot of people say you can't get in a vegetarian diet. So somewhere during the day, there'll be something like that in there.
Hanli chooses to eat according to her beliefs. Whether you're dining in or out, she advises checking which types of fish are on the green list. And sticking to these is a step in the right direction.
You know, you're really someone who practices what you preach. What can we do to make a difference?
Well, to begin with, you can start experimenting with delicious vegetarian food and try to be a slightly more responsible consumer. So whether it is from eating less meat and fish, or maybe getting like a Green Monday thing going where you don't eat meat on a Monday, to how much packaging and how much plastic we use. So much of that ends up in the ocean, and at some point that becomes a huge problem. So all the way from what you eat to what you use, everyone can make a difference.
I like it, making a difference one meal at a time.
Bon appetit.
Next, the best fashion news this week is that Woolworths has partnered with SA Fashion Week to fast-track South African designers from the runway to the rails. It's a move to support homegrown talent where it matters most, commercially.
To celebrate their new collaboration, Woolworths opened SA Fashion Week with a cocktail party at hot new Jersey restaurant Marble.
Priscilla, I've been fortunate enough to have worked with you in these sort of busy situations. It's SA Fashion Week. Tell us about your collaboration with Woolworths, that partnership that you've taken on. How much of an impact is that going to make in this year's SA Fashion Week?
Well, I think this year is going to make a huge impact. But for me, it's not only about this year. It's about the future. I mean, what are we going to do with these fantastic designers? How are we going to give them retail opportunities in the future? And that is really what I'm looking forward to.
That's really exciting, and I know you always have to keep it exciting. So what should we be looking forward to, and what's on top of your list?
For me, the most important thing in South Africa is our diversity. So that is what you're going to see. You're going to see a different collection from every single designer projecting their cultural background, their design soul, and that is what brings the magic to the South African Fashion Week.
At the same time, Woolies has relaunched its popular Style by SA collaboration with local trendsetters. Maps Mapunyane met Noni Gasa to get the scoop.
With so many local brands and designers starting to show all over the world, it's really beginning to feel that African fashion is starting to become a global force.
Absolutely, and we believe that the key to unlocking that is investment and access to markets. So our collaboration with SA Fashion Week and Style by SA Stylists are both ways in which we are proudly supporting local talent.
Okay, so Style by SA really sounds like an exciting project on its own. Tell us a bit about that.
For this campaign, we've got a group of the most talented South African stylists in one campaign, styling themselves, directing the shoots, taking complete creative control of the content. So what I think you'll be seeing is something that's very true to all the individuals involved in this campaign.
Wow, well, that all sounds like really good stuff. So let's go meet all these Style by SA stylists and see how they're getting on.
Yes, please.
Stylists like Tsepi Vundla are pairing Fashion Week showstoppers with Woolies brands.
What I love about the pants are it's wide leg, they're funky, and you can dress them up and down.
What do you never leave the house without?
I cannot live without my eyebrow filler.
I'm wearing a blazer from Taylor Me, and I love that it adds a sophisticated edge to my look.
B Diamond Head was in her element.
I'm wearing a young designer named Somerset Jane. I like that it's so versatile. It's classic, yet it's also pretty casual. You can dress it up, you can dress it down. And I've teamed it with some nice Woolies brands like Mimco and Witchery, so it's exciting.
Papama had this take.
What's exciting for you in SA fashion right now?
Social media has completely leveled the playing ground. So small brands, big brands, it's fair game for everyone. So I think we're really onto something.
Sharon Becker spots trends.
What's your top summer style tip?
I think baring the shoulders. To me, it's a very flattering part of the woman's body to show. And it's subtly sexy without being too revealing.
Doesn't matter what you wear, feeling good is always what it's always about. If you don't feel good, it's really hard to look good. So for me, it's about having a great attitude about yourself, having a great attitude about the clothes you're wearing, and the rest will take care of itself.
Stylistas arrived in chauffeur-driven class. It was a fashion lover's dream, as 400 of the industry's leading lights, celebrities, editors, and designers settled in at Hyde Park for the first show. In the front row were the Style by SA squad, phones charged and at the ready. Each of them had a distinct take on the collections, and there was no end of fascinating insight.
Tonight has been really, really interesting. Beautiful garments. I love the first show. It's always refreshing to see what the new talent's doing.
For me, Fashion Week is always an exciting space. It almost feels like my second home, and I look at Fashion Week as a place for homework, where you get inspired and you get to go back home and, I guess, reflect and see how we can move fashion forward.
My highlight tonight has just been all the stylists coming together and just seeing all our outfits because we didn't source together.
Really excited seeing some amazing designers tonight, having a fantastic time. Style by SA!
You can see and feel the excitement of growing talented local designers.
And that's it for the first night of SA Fashion Week. All done, and it was great. But for now, let's off to the after party. See you later.
Catch trend reports and exclusive content from SA Fashion Week on woolworths.co.za.
Next, you might know him for his groundbreaking skin surgery, but have you met Dr. Ridwan Mia, interior design talent?
Our guests this week do this country so much credit, like Dr. Ridwan Mia. As a respected reconstructive surgeon, he's well known among South Africans. But with all his time dedicated to his work, this eminent doctor really did benefit from some expert styling of this, his bachelor pad.
Moving in here was an opportunity for Dr. Ridwan Mia to teach himself about design and developing ideas for spatial planning and positioning to create comfortable living areas. It was a second education for a man whose interests run from hand and palate surgery to his extensive work with burn injuries.
Dr. Mia, you're most well known for the surgery you did on Pippi, which was quite revolutionary.
Pippi Kruger was a 2.5-year-old girl who got burnt in a family braai. She sustained burns to 80% of her body. It was full thickness burns, and we battled to get her over that. And eventually we came to a point where it was time to cover her wounds. And so we cloned her skin in the United States and brought it back to South Africa and then covered her wounds. So it was quite something. It was a question of need at the time. And none of us realized that it was something as groundbreaking.
It's amazing how modern science can give a person a new lease on life.
Absolutely. I think the field of tissue engineering is fairly new in medicine. And I think the next decade or so is going to be very significant in that regard.
He drives the best of British, so it's no surprise to find the good doctor lives in a classic English-style cluster home. Here, the architecture of the neighbourhood gives the feel of park living, which has sentimental value to him.
Dr. Mia, this estate really reminds me of a little quaint suburb in London.
I think that was the idea, is to capture the feel of an English village. And for me, it really worked because it reminded me of my days of working back in the UK.
I think they've done a pretty good job.
Yeah, absolutely. I think they did. We can go in.
When he bought the property, it had a farmhouse feel, but he's gone for a more classic, luxurious look.
Wow, Dr. Mia, this is really, really lovely.
Thank you very much.
I must tell you, this is definitely one of the tidiest bachelor pads I've ever seen.
Remember, this is a plastic surgeon bachelor, so it should be different.
I'm assuming you did the deco as well.
I did. It took me a long time, but I think eventually it's getting together.
It's a home.
It's a home, absolutely. Let me show you.
Great. I love what you've done in this room.
Thank you very much. It's a quiet room for me, somewhere I like to spend reading, and it captures a nice warm, homely feel.
What was the inspiration?
I wanted to have a homely feel about it, so the colors, the textures, it just gave me an idea that I'm at home and I'm comfortable and it's a secure place.
That is a really beautiful tapestry. Do you collect a lot of pieces when you travel?
Yes, I do. This particular piece is from Iran. I love the work, the intricate work, and then I love bringing things home, which makes me feel like I'm back in those places again. And the tapestry ties in nicely with the Moroccan lamp on the side, so it worked.
I can't wait to see more.
The choices he made have been influenced by the internet, home shows, travel, and asking friends, family, or decor experts.
Luna, this is Taryn. She's here to help give us some tips on how to host a dinner party. Being a bachelor, it's very difficult, and I can use all the help I can get.
I can imagine. Taryn, you must have some great tips for somebody who doesn't want to fuss over making a dining room table look absolutely gorgeous.
Firstly, Luna, we want to keep the look fairly strong and simple, so we've decided to add a touch of modern to this fairly traditional look. We started by using these leather placemats mixed with these beautiful raw linen napkins just to add a nice contrast to the texture of the materials on the table.
The wooden furniture gives this room a bold look and complements what Taryn's done.
I wanted to have a nice sized dining room table so that I could invite many friends over at a time. I like the warm feeling that brings having lots of guests over at the same time. And also I wanted the sideboards to have enough room so that I could keep, for example, some of my awards together at the same time as you know, showing them off, I guess. And also to be able to have some room for food and some of the condiments. limits we have with our food.
Taryn, the flower arrangements are really impressive.
I've gone with some fairly interesting glassware along with some architectural flowers just to make sure that the look is very simple yet strong, especially nice and easy for a bachelor to do himself.
Dr. Mia, I hope when you have your next dinner party, I'm on that guest list.
Top billing team will definitely be on that list.
Love it.
Steadily pieced together from various journeys he's been on throughout the world, the Pajama Lounge is his favorite space for its cozy yet exotic feel.
So throughout the house, you've noticed that I've had various Persian carpets. I have a weakness for them. I really enjoy learning about where they come from. If you look at this one, it's an Indian piece and then an Afghanistani piece behind the glass, something I thought I'd preserve, and you know, all over the house. I think the idea is that so much hard work has gone into it. They hand knotted, there's so much skill that's gone into them, and the various geographical regions where they originate. You know, you look at a carpet and you can tell so much about the place where it comes from, the colors, the way the knots are made, and the various kind of blends of silk and wool, and they all tell a story by themselves, and I think that's what makes them so valuable.
A man of science, he also has an instinct for collectible art.
I've got various pieces which make me remember the time that I got them in, so they're really treasured pieces as well.
Now that is a showpiece and definitely must have an interesting story to it.
Sure, I actually found that in Franschhoek, and you know, I saw it first a year before I actually bought it, and I was quite surprised that it was still there. And the owner of the store was about to take it off the floor, and there was no way I was going to let that happen. So I had to have it specially transported myself. And then I discovered that the outer portion of it was actually from a 300-year-old Indonesian window, which makes the piece more special, and it just fitted perfectly into that corner.
The master bedroom offers another insight into his sentimental nature and the importance of family.
Dr. Mia, you're clearly a man who loves gold.
Well, I think it's come over the years. You know, it's very much used in my parents' house, and I've got used to that. So it makes me feel like home as well. And also, it's a very warm, earthy color, and it goes with lots of other colors and textures. So yeah, I think I do like it a lot. But what really makes my bedroom special is waking up to that view. You know, to be able to bring the outside inside, to hear the birds, to see the trees, you know, and to look out onto the street. I think that's really special for me.
A real treat is having brunch in the conservatory during summer or sitting on the garden bench and appreciating the view. In winter, when the oak trees have lost their leaves, Dr. Mia enjoys few things better than brewing a fresh cup of coffee and enjoying the warm winter sun.
Coffee and chocolate, just what the doctor ordered.
I love it. This conservatory is certainly English.
It's actually my favorite place in the house because it brings the kitchen into the garden and makes it feel like one continuous space.
Dr. Mia, I think you're one person who can tell me whether chocolate and coffee are good for us. And we love it so much. It's such a weakness.
Well, you know, in limited amounts, dark chocolate can be very good for your skin. It's got lots of antioxidants and it's helpful to give you a bright, rejuvenated skin. And also the caffeine in the coffee can be good for you in small amounts. The moment you exceed a certain limit, then it's pro-aging. So one has to be careful, not too much coffee. With that being said, though, one should look after one's skin overall. You know, lots of hydration, lots of water, avoid the sun, use sunscreen, have a good skincare regimen, you know, just take good care of your skin if you want it to look great.
Well, if the doctor said it, I think I'm gonna go ahead and have one. Thank you so much for having us in your home.
It's a pleasure. Thank you for being here.
This bachelor's decor advice is to break with what you're used to, challenge your own stereotypes, and to travel to open your mind.
And that's our thank you to the good doctor for all he's doing each day, making difficult lives that little bit easier.
Up next, each runs a world top 50 restaurant, but is one kitchen big enough for both of them? Plus, it's a fine looking machine, but can it beat real horsepower?
African? It may not be a combination you've heard of before, but I assure you it was delicious. The night that two of the best Mexican and South African chefs got together in one kitchen to make history of the most scrumptious kind.
Lorna was about to taste the cooking of Luke Dale Roberts and Jorge Vallejo. Both chefs have establishments rated in the top 30 of the world's 50 best restaurants.
This is the first time an event of this magnitude has ever happened in South Africa. What can guests look forward to this evening?
You first, eh?
Okay, well, I took some ingredients from Mexico all the way down, so I think you should be prepared to have really, really Mexican flavors. We took some grasshoppers, we took some ant larvae, things that maybe the people are not expecting to eat, but it's so delicious and it's part of the tradition, Mexican tradition, so it's good.
This menu literally bursts with so much flavor. How did you come up with it?
So it's, yeah, I took some of the tried and tested classics from the test kitchen menu, and then we developed a couple of new little dishes. So we've done a little test kitchen taco to tip the old hats to the Mexicans, so to speak. And then I kind of put together my ideas, and Jorge put together his ideas, and then we just communicated by email. And then, yeah, the whole thing pulled together.
16 courses, that's a lot of food. How did you find a balance?
They're tiny. You're going to manage. I think we've just communicated, and I think we were quite lucky as well, eh? That, like, all the courses are sufficiently small, and the high points start, you know, like nice and fresh, and it's got a ceviche up there early, and then, you know, I've got a dish with liquid nitrogen, like a smoked sea bass dish, and so it just kind of, I think it's going to fit.
The flavors would come thick and fast. Smoked sea bass with frozen horseradish and lime compressed apples. Pine needle granita with gin and tonic jelly and compressed cucumber. Sweetbread with a smoked grape stuffing and pine nut bechamel. Resistance was futile.
My dearest Amizi, what happens when you put the best of South Africa and the best of Mexico on one continent?
Let me think. I think I see some tacos, nachos, some brewerio risa, some mojitos.
I can see that as well, but I can tell you now, you're about to have the best 16-course tasting menu of your life. We're gonna have a good time.
I love it spicy. Let's go. No, that's Spanish.
Oh, okay.
Mexican.
I'm there.
That's the one.
150 places were available, and inside 3 hours of being announced, every seat in the house was sold out.
Ambassador Escanero, tonight is such an exciting evening to literally have the best of South Africa and the best of Mexico on one continent. How did the idea come about?
We are so excited indeed. We have two of the best chefs of the world, and the idea, it comes under the initiative called Ven a Comer, that it stands for come to eat, come to share our food, come to enjoy our cuisine. It's a Mexican flagship program to promote our culinary culture, which is recognized as World Heritage by UNESCO. And we thought that South Africa is an excellent platform for this initiative, and we want to get closer to South Africa. We want to be closer to the Rainbow Nation. That is what we are doing here. We are building a bridge of friendship.
And no better way to do this than with these gastronomic wonders. Toast with seaweed ashes and spicy mayonnaise. Aged beef, a revelation with grasshopper chimichurri. Wild oyster mushrooms served with a broad bean puree. Golden sunflower seeds in a honeycomb brown butter. Mexico occupies a special place in world cuisine. It's the country that taught the world to eat corn in all its many ways. And judging by the sparkling menu, it isn't a nation to sit on its laurels.
It's amazing. Yeah. This has truly been an awakening of our palates. How amazing has today been?
I'm sold on anything Mexican-South African combination. I'm definitely coming back here. It's been an eye-opener or eye-opening experience. But more than anything, my palate is doing a carnival.
Luke and Jorge love pushing boundaries using their local produce. And for 3 nights, they got to cook flavors from the far side of the world.
Mexican or South African, both ways you win. The same applied for the choice of horsepower at this year's Land Rover Africa Cup. That's where a woman had to ask herself whether she prefers a man on horseback or behind the wheel of a fabulous new machine.
The Land Rover Africa Cup is where the continent's top new polo talents announce themselves amidst tough opposition. Another star draw card this year was the world's first luxury compact convertible SUV.
John and I at the Inanda Club for the Africa Cup 2016 Polo Tournament to enjoy a great day of polo and also see what kind of development is going into the game.
And we had to celebrate the launch of an exciting new addition to the Land Rover family, the Evoque convertible. And of course I pulled rank, and I was the first one in South Africa to drive this little beauty over here. Not him, not the youngster.
Heard about that, but I get to race it.
Why? What? Why do you get to race it?
This stunning debutante combines bold lines, design and refinement with a brand's traditional luxury and a folding roof to create a no-compromise, all-season convertible.
It's like I'm still trying to get my head around the fact that we're in a convertible SUV. It's a lot to kind of put your head around, isn't it?
It is indeed, Jonathan. You must clearly be doing something right, because you're one of the first people in South Africa to be driving in the Evoque convertible. We're currently driving just below 48 kilometers an hour, and I'm going to show you that we are going to take
the roof's coming off while we're going.
The roof lowers itself in 18 seconds.
Now we're talking. That is so cool. Apart from that, one of the first things you notice when you get into the car is, of course, the ultra-luxury finishes, and that's what Range Rover is so well known for.
Absolutely. We are surrounded by Oxford leather with beautiful contrast stitching and aluminium finishes to give you that contemporary, modern feel.
The nice wide touchscreen is something new as well. We haven't seen something like this before.
That's correct. So your radio operates from there, your iPod connectivity, your dual climate control, as well as your navigation.
It seems to have taken car entertainment to a whole new level. You've got a massive 10.2-inch screen, nice widescreen, speakers everywhere you look, literally.
Much cleaner design. Mm-hmm. You're surrounded by 12 speakers. It's operated by a sound system called Meridian. If you want to, you can also upgrade to an 18-speaker digital surround sound system, which will blast you away with 660 watts.
It's like the best of both worlds, isn't it? You've got a convertible and you've got an SUV, so whether you want to cruise on the open road with the roof down or you want to hit the outdoors with the roof down, you've got it all.
2016 also sees the arrival of two young polo talents playing in their first international tournament.
We have a number of development players playing today in the Africa Cup. During the course of the year, we had the Land Rover Development Cup, and there we identified two young and upcoming stars in the polo world. Lucky Msinga and Tokozani Zondo are playing today and are part of the Above and Beyond team.
So where did your love for horses start? And speaking of playing polo, when did you start doing that?
And then I was involved.
And what does it mean to you to be a polo player?
Joining Tokozani and Lucky to make up a potent team are seasoned international pros Terence Spilsbury and Richard Pohl.
Richard, how important is development in the game of polo?
The development in polo is obviously very important. The Land Rover Africa Cup is a great base to give development players the opportunity to play in higher goal polo. Combining some older experienced players with the young up-and-coming guys, it's proving to be a good combination.
And what is the greater vision or goal?
If we can get the players to improve and get them to a higher and higher standard, hopefully in the future we can see these guys playing in the green and gold.
It was an all-African festival of colour and style from the celebrity guests, with looks from Ghana, South Africa, Uganda and across the continent, including the designs of entrepreneur and fashionista Ayanda Nhlapo.
Ayanda, I love your ensemble. I love what you've been putting together. What's behind all of this?
Okay, so what's behind my outfit is the theme called Quintessentially African. That's this year's theme for the polo tournament. So I decided, put together a lovely collection titled Born in the Wild, Raised in the City, to celebrate the wild side of life and the city side of life, merge it together and boom.
What brought you to the polo today?
I was actually invited by Sia Kolisi here, and he just said, he's going to be in Joburg and I should come with him to the polo. And I was like, okay, cool, I'll come through, and that's a pretty great event.
Well, we know what you're capable of on the field, on your own two legs. What do you think you would be capable of on a horse such as the ones down over there?
I think probably the only thing would be take my girlfriend on a long beach walk with the horses on the beach, maybe something like that.
Ah, sweet man, he went the romantic route.
Sia, what is it about the polo that you love so much? Besides, of course, the fact that you built like these animals too.
I think it's my first game of polo. I'm happy that Land Rover invited me today. You know, they've got nice cars, but they're also getting me cultured a little bit. But I really enjoyed. But the one thing I love the most is just the dress up, how to see people dress up in the fashion, you know.
A fierce competitor himself, Sia was looking forward to the horsepower battle between Polo Pony and Evoke.
It is a real race based on horsepower. We have a little bit more horsepower perhaps than the actual horse, but the horse has got home advantage because it's on the grass surface. Do we have a chance, or are we just going to skid on the grass?
Yeah, we're going to get a little bit of wheel spin, but given the fact that it's the first time Range Rover Evoke is out on the surface, slightly wet out there today, we're going to have to use all technology from its all-wheel drive systems to its terrain response. Fantastic being a Range Rover, 2-litre four-cylinder turbocharged petrol engine, 177 kilowatts, 0 to 100, 7.6. We got a good chance.
Are we going to win this race?
I'm going to.
It was muscle versus metal. Off the line, four legs shot out to an early lead over the competition. But the vehicle's traction, torque, power, and control could not be withstood for long.
We won!
With Africa's best polo teams and most valuable players crowned, John and Maps got better acquainted with that dream convertible.
Awesome, so that wraps up a very successful day. The weather hasn't kept the crowds away. It's been such a cool time.
Everyone's had a really good time. We got to drive this amazing car, and guess what? Mm-hmm. I got the keys.
Key sweet road trip, baby.
Yep.
You drive.
Wait. I know my place.
Yes, sir.
can you let me in? Can you, John, can you open the door?
And now we go.
I'm going to say, in the country, I prefer a man on a horse, but in the city, a convertible SUV, of course.
Still to come, when you're as in love on your silver anniversary as you were on the day you got married, it's entirely reasonable to get married again.
Boy and Letty and Ngobeni have lived such a happy 26 years of married life together that they wanted to relive their wedding day and renew their vows with their children this time. And who better to make it an unforgettable day than Sophie Ndaba?
The couple met on April the 25th, 1990. It's been a classic love story ever since, and one worthy of this magical dress.
It is indescribable knowing that Gert is he's kind of an international designer, designing for all the celebrities. And today I'm wearing Gert Johan Gutierrez's dress. I feel so good. I feel like an African queen.
For Letty's dress, I really wanted her to look like the African queen that she is. So I wanted to show her figure and her curves and just really bring across her best features by emphasizing her waist, bringing this across to show off her stunning shoulders. And of course, with a wedding, the most important thing is it's about the bride's face. And you want to bring all the attention up to that. So the dress should never be wearing her, she should be wearing the dress. And that's exactly what I think is happening here today. And we didn't want it to go for a traditional veil, so we decided to design this detachable cape as a veil, just for that drama factor when she walks in, you know?
Also stepping out in Gert originals would be the bridesmaids, including Benita, their daughter. Boy had all three of their sons as groomsmen, each of them matching their dad's impressive suit by designer Baledi Sihapo.
Well, the look for Mr. Ngobeni wanted to keep it very 3D. What I mean when I say 3D, if you look at this shirt, it's got basically three types of fabrics on it, because that's what men's clothes are about, that element of surprise. You can actually see the three different textures, even with his bow tie. And when you look at his suit, which is 100% woolen fabric, again, you can see the element of 3D there, and I like what we've managed to achieve here with the, we call this window pane fabric. And I felt that we need to definitely give him a waistcoat so that he actually has a very nice silhouette at the end of the day.
The happiest day in my life, 26 years of marriage to my wife, lovely woman, woman of prayer. We have always wanted this day. We knew one day it will come, and now is the day, now is the time. After that 26 years, three great sons, and my only daughter, and that's favorite, Benita, What more can one wish for? I love my wife, I love my family. They are the secret behind myself. Whatever I do, they made me the best head of department in the country. That's thanks to my wife, every day, every night. I love it.
If their lives have navigated troubled waters, then they've each been the other's bridge over them, an example to their family.
I'm sure we all agree when we say the one thing you want to see is to see your mother happy and just for her dreams to come true, you know. And the fact that my father is that man who does that for her is absolutely amazing. So being dressed up, being here is, I love it. You know, Hert is an amazing designer. We all look beautiful and I love it.
I'm currently studying in Cyprus. I'm doing my fourth year in civil engineering. So I usually come back in June for the holidays. So the reason they made the wedding in September was so they could accommodate me. I think that just goes to show what kind of parents they are, you know. Like, they want us all to be together as a family. So, yeah, I feel very lucky, you know. I'm blessed to have parents like them.
Today is just full of surprises. I think everybody's in a very jolly mood, but the wedding is at a different level. And for them to have been married for so long and to do a white wedding now, I think it really means a lot to them. And we're just here to share that excitement with them.
After 26 years of marriage, and they're still so in love and they're still so on together. So I'm so happy for them and I wish them well.
Boy is head of e-government in Gauteng, and Letty is a leading businesswoman. Sophie Ndaba's experience to plan this special day for them could not be topped.
She's a bling lady, but however, very Princess Di kind of, you know, because she's a very giving person and a very loving person. So for me, I needed to bring that out through her. That's hence the long supper table, because she's a very spiritual woman. So for me, when I speak to a client, it's not about, oh, let's do a fabulous decor. No, it's about looking at the person, look at the persona and saying, what does this person represent? So for me, doing the long supper tables, not doing every table like that, but do you know that long supper table is quite exciting, because then all the husbands and MECs are sitting on the long supper and all the family members are sitting on one long supper. Then, you know, the couches are more for the younger people who just wanted to lounge around. And, you know, I loved it. I think it was something new and fresh, and I loved it, yeah.
Letty's been an entrepreneur from the age of 12, and Boy Ngobeni is helping small businesses through IT. But here, it was all about their fairy tale romance.
They're so beautiful together. You can see they're just one of those couples that are even starting to look alike. So I'm not surprised to hear that they've been together for 26 years. I hope that I will have the same story to tell like they have told us today, and I love them. They look great together and they complement each other well.
It's really clear that these two people inspire each other to do better, to commit more, to serve more. And I think all we can say is we wish them another wonderful 26 years.
We wish
years.
Them a long and happy marriage. Let them be together, love each other, respect one another. And we wish them more years to come, and they prosper well and be a happy couple. Hola, Boy and Letty, keep it up. Sharp, sharp.
This couple have made their own success and have helped others to do the same. They live every moment to the full.
It was such a great day. I feel renewed, energized, ready for another 26 years of marriage, for Lobola 3. Looking forward to having the third wedding in 26 years.
When we were planning this wedding, we said, you know what, when you do something, you need to do it well or go home if you can't do it well. So we decided that we're going to go all out with our outfit. So now we have just changed. We look so beautiful. We look amazing. And the day went so well. I'm extremely happy.
And we are ready to hit the floor.
Yes,
you haven't seen
we're ready to hit the dance floor.
We look forward to the next party around the year 2042.
How can we not be inspired by that couple and the doctors, conservationists, chefs, designers, mermaids and little baby rhinos who make this such a buzzing and brilliant country to live, work and play in. Until next week from this proud South African, it's good night and God bless.
Next Thursday, champions for natural hair, Bonimbuli and Samgelo Ndlovu say wear your crown with pride. After season best figures of 13 for 144, Kagiso Rabada takes 5 in Mauritius. And Folk Music's Matthew Mole returns to play the venue where he met his wife, Amy.